Understanding is a continuing process, and it embraces many different aspects of our day-to-day living. It is, at root, a function which involves the flow of information.
We live amid the greatest abundance of information any people has ever had. But survey after survey reveals an astonishingly low informational level among us. To be sure, the right to remain uninformed is one of the privileges of a democracy, but in a contest such as the one we are engaged in, it is one of the surest ways of losing our freedoms.
Confidence by itself, without effort, does not win contests. Victory in this conflict depends on much, much more than confidence. It is a contest unlike any we have ever faced in our history as a nation.
Just think, a little handful of people can change the whole course of history.
Well, maybe more than a handful.
I mean, just that, a handful. 1% is nothing more than a handful. And just think what that 1% has been doing to mess up the world. And they get in the fields that count. Call them what you like, they have one thing in common. They hate the basic truth on which our nation is founded, that every human being is a child of God, and that he gets his rights from God, and that the purpose of state is to protect those God-given rights. They, every one of them, get into fields where they can eliminate that truth. I don't think many people realize the close connection that the founders of our country explicitly stated was between God and country. Over and over again, they emphasized that was the cornerstone of our liberty. Then 4 times in the Declaration of Independence, they repeated over and over again that our liberty depends upon God.
That's right.
Do you know the Declaration, Paul?
Naturally. It goes as follows. When in the course of human events it becomes necessary for one people to dissolve the political bonds which have connected them with another and to assume among the powers of the earth the separate and equal station to which the laws of nature and of nature's God entitle them.
Remarkable, Paul. You're one of the first persons I've ever met that know that much of the Declaration.
We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights.
The last paragraph.
We therefore, the representatives of the United States of America in General Congress assembled, appealing to the supreme judge of the world.
You know, that 1%'s a cozy group. All they want to do is tear the heart out of the Declaration.
They want to destroy the very pursuit of happiness, the whole reason for being. For over 3,000 years, the Jews have carried the sublime truth that man is made in the image and likeness of God, that he has an eternal destiny. They don't want man to know his sacred worth, and that's why they swarm into every field they can to eliminate every trace of man's dignity. They want to wipe it out, eliminate it from the face of the earth. Our forefathers left us a wonderful pattern, a heritage we should cherish. Each one of us can play a part in preserving it. Yes. You and you and you and everybody else can do something to change the world for the better.
Come on, this only works if you let go too.
We will not be driven by fear into an age of unreason if we dig deep in our history and our doctrine, and remember that we are not descended from fearful men, not from men who feared to write, to associate, to speak, and to defend the causes that were for the moment unpopular.
It doesn't matter which side runs the village.
It's run by one side or the other.
Oh, certainly. But both sides are becoming identical. What, in fact, has been created? An international community. A perfect blueprint for world order. When the sides facing each other suddenly realize that they're looking into a mirror, they will see that this is the pattern for the future.
The whole earth. As the village. Yes.
That is my hope. What's yours?
I'd like to be the first man on the moon.
I will not be pushed, filed, stamped, indexed, briefed, debriefed, or numbered. My life is my own.
And the aim of this is to give you, the user, the person, the individual, the power to change what's on the screen. Because in the 20th century, if you can't change what's on the screen, if you can't orchestrate and direct and move these electrons around, your mind and your life is being controlled by the people who do control the screen.
In this video, you're going to see
subliminal messages.
Smoke.
About a little girl named
Alice.
I don't want to hear it.
Alice.
do?
She visits a strange land where strange people do strange things.
Tell you what I do like, though.
Pie.
A dyed in the wool, a cold-blooded clean cut.
You talk about subliminal.
I'd be very pleased to know what they think they're doing.
Known knowns. There are things we know we know.
You know what they say, Timmy.
Smoke. We also know there are known unknowns. That is to say, we know there are some things we do not know.
What's that, Lassie?
But there are also unknown unknowns. The ones we don't know, we don't know.
Yeah, listen.
Let me tell you something about
Alice. Alice. Alice.
They'll come at you sideways.
Just smoke.
It's how they think. It's how they move.
Since the price of oil affects just about everything,
let everybody sing.
Alice. 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 Alice.
Are you smoking yet?
Ice cream, you scream.
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 Yeah, baby.
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 Could this be the end?
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 This be the end.
This be the end.
This be the end.
This be the end.
Could this be the end?
Could this be the end?
This be the end.
This be the end.
This be the end.
Could this be the end?
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 2,000 years later.
Yeah, baby. Yeah, baby.
Yeah, baby. Yeah, baby.
Yeah, baby.
HARP began with a congressional insertion in the appropriations bill of fiscal year 1990. In essence, Congress directed the Defense Department to explore the potential for using the auroral regions for improving communications and navigation and surveillance.
HARP's combined antennae generate a focused billion-watt high-frequency radio beam, which penetrates the lower ionosphere and interacts with the currents of the auroral electrojet. During this modification, this pulsing beam stimulates the ionosphere, creating ELF waves which can move great distances through the lower atmosphere.
I don't even understand what you mean by energy. Humans are made up of energy. What does that mean? Safety is the main consideration here. We have followed all the standards that are applicable. HARP has no effect on the Earth. HARP will not affect animals or birds. That's in the environmental impact statement. It's not up to me to determine that it is or is not a valid expenditure of taxpayers' funds. I'm told to do this, and we are doing it.
I'm told to do this, and we are doing it.
HARP cannot be used as a weapon.
Anything that the Air Force needs for space, we look into. And that includes weapons for space application, one of which is developing plasma toroids, projectiles made of plasma, essentially the atmosphere of stars, being able to harness that energy and to be able to fire it at a target. We have a device called Shiva. Shiva is a large capacitor bank. Capacitors store electrical energy. And then in a very short time, we release that energy. In about 200 millionths of a second, we will release the same amount of energy as the entire U.S. electrical production for that same instant in time, where the electrons rip from their orbits and you have a soupy gaseous mixture thousands of degrees hot, potentially a very serious weapon.
And if you aim the beam at the down, and it happens to be in a region where there's a lot of charge, you can initiate a discharge in that area, perhaps. I have not heard of ionospheric warfare. I don't even know what the term means.
The bomb will not start a chain reaction in the water, converting it all to gas and letting all the ships on all the oceans drop down to the bottom. It will not blow out the bottom of the sea and let all the water run down the hole. It will not destroy gravity. I am not an atomic playboy.
If you think that bankers are the same as you, you're wrong. F. Scott Fitzgerald once told Hemingway, you know, the rich are different from us. And Hemingway said, yeah, they have more money. And F. Scott Fitzgerald replied, no, it's something much deeper. It's a whole different world. To be an oligarch, to be a Rockefeller or something of this sort, means that you're in a completely different world with values which are the reverse of human values. Now, over the past decades, since the Kennedy assassination approximately, you've had an ongoing oligarchical transformation of virtually every country in the world. And in the United States, it's taken the form of an oligarchical counter-revolution against the reforms of the 1930s, with the Wall Street interest asserting itself as more and more dominant. And once bankers and oligarchs have power, it's like the way a plant responds. Naturally, since they're oligarchs, they're going to try to downgrade the standard of living of the vast majority of the population. They're going to claim that the world is overpopulated, that industrialization, industrial pollution, and overpopulation are the main problems that face the world. And they're generally going to try to crush and mortify any kind of popular democracy or mass movements with any kind of progressive content. Oligarchy as a ruling class is posed by Plato in The Republic, where we find that oligarchy is a constitution full of many evils, where the rich dominate the government by buying it, and the average individual or the poor count for absolutely nothing. Oligarchy is a frame of mind. In other words, if you're a banker, this is already a worldview. It's a world outlook, and it implies the policies that have got us here, right? Malthusian policies, zero growth policies, driving down the standard of living, attempts to wipe out all kinds of mass institutions that might be a countervailing force. If you try to let the finance oligarchs who created the crisis turn around and say they're the doctors who are going to get you out of the crisis, they will dig you deeper and deeper into the bottomless abyss of world economic depression, financial collapse, and disintegration. The destruction of world civilization is a matter of a few decades at the very, very most. So, choose.
I'm William K. Black, Associate Professor of Economics and Law at the University of Missouri, Kansas City. I was a senior regulator in a number of different positions during the heart of the savings and loan crisis. On a staff level, I led the re-regulation of the savings and loan industry. The purpose of regulation and effective criminal prosecution is to make sure that cheaters don't prosper, that honest manufacturers win in competition. The primary driver of the current crisis is accounting control fraud. These are frauds led by the CEOs of the major lending institutions and major banks and institutional buyers of toxic waste product. How did it start? It started with mortgages, particularly non-prime mortgages. In September of 2004, the FBI warned that there was an epidemic of mortgage fraud, their words, and that this epidemic of mortgage fraud would cause an economic crisis at least as large as the savings and loan debacle if it wasn't stopped. The FBI found that 80% of the mortgage fraud was being induced by the lenders, not by the borrowers. You know, much of the rage has been against the borrowers. But if you want rage, it should be at the CEOs who became fabulously wealthy by following a strategy based on fraud.
As a nation, we began by declaring all men are created equal. There was no mention of any exception to that rule in the Declaration of Independence. But we now practically read it, all men are created equal except Negroes. If we are to accept this doctrine of race or class discrimination, what is to stop us in future from decreeing all men are created equal except Negroes, foreigners, Catholics, Jews, or just poor people? That is the conclusion towards which the advocates of slavery are driving us. Let each state mind its own business, says Judge Douglas. Why stir up trouble? This is the complacent policy of indifference to evil. And that policy I cannot but hate. I hate it because of the monstrous injustice of slavery itself. I hate it because it deprives our republic of its just influence in the world, enables the enemies of free institutions everywhere to taunt us as hypocrites, causes the real friends of freedom to doubt our sincerity, and especially because it forces so many good men among ourselves into an open war with the very fundamentals of civil liberty, denying the good faith of the Declaration of Independence and insisting that there is no right principle of action but self-interest. It is the same spirit which says you toil and work and earn bread and I'll eat it. There can be no distinction in the definition of liberty as between one section and another, one class and another, one race and another. A house divided against itself cannot stand. I am not preaching rebellion. I don't have to. This country with its institutions belongs to the people who inhabit it. Whenever they shall grow weary of the existing government, they can exercise their constitutional right of amending it, or their revolutionary right to dismember or overthrow it. If the founding fathers gave us anything, they gave us that.
The day we went out to Waco was 7 days into the siege. And what I find fascinating, and I'll try and make this brief, footage that's been running on Access, an actual representation, is what you see is a Bradley tank shooting fire into the compound, which is exactly what is against the party line, which is that they shot tear gas into the compound and the Branch Davidians started the fire. Now, what this implies is, A, if in fact this footage is real, and we're about to show it for you, the FBI, the ATF, Janet Reno, up to Clinton, are liars and murderers. And if they had any honor whatsoever, they would commit harikari if they were true human beings. And B, the real implication is why no mainstream media has picked up on this footage and thought that it was news. This tells you something about America and the state of freedom that you live under.
If you look real close, you should see some flames of interest here, I do believe.
That's the Bradley tank. Now watch it come out. Flames coming from the turret. Do you see that?
Pretty clear.
It again. The Bradley tank comes out. Flames.
Gee, is that fire, Bill?
It looks like fire to me. So the implications of this, I mean, just ponder that. Every mainstream media news source told us that they launched tear gas in order to convince the moms and the kids to get out. This, meanwhile, as you can see, they're destroying the compound which the kids were inside of. How they knew that they weren't going to run a kid over, I don't know. Just think of what that implies.
The fact that no one has picked up on this news story except public access, A, and B, that the ATF and FBI are liars and murderers, and if they had any honor, if they were truly human beings, they would explain their role in this murder and mass murder of innocent children and women. But why it's not newsworthy, you tell me. You call me and tell me why that's not on the news.
And it's becoming so transparent, their fucking lie, that it's laughable. And that's all I want to say on that. They want you to be a docile, apathetic herd of consumers, of corporate products. The majority of people are fucking reasonable and fucking intelligent, and we don't have a fucking voice. We are the fucking government. We are the fucking people. And I think there's going to be a change with what we imagine we can create. And that goes for heaven, and that goes for hell, and it is our choice, and we can do anything, literally. Confucius said, "What is the sound of one hand clapping?" And he said it in this enigmatic way to state that there is no sound. And you know what I say?
Go.
Fuck Confucius. Let's move on.
These economic factors may take some spring out of the Easter Bunny step this year.
Economic factors may take some spring out of the Easter Bunny step this year.
Economic factors may take some spring out of the Easter Bunny step this year.
Economic factors may take some spring out of the Easter Bunny step this year.
Economic factors may take some spring out of the Easter Bunny step this year.
Economic factors may take some spring out of the Easter Bunny step this year.
Economic factors may take some spring out of the Easter Bunny step this year.
Economic factors may take some spring out of the Easter Bunny step this year.
Economic factors may take some spring out of the Easter Bunny step this year.
Economic factors may take some spring out of the Easter Bunny step this year.
Economic factors may take some spring out of the Easter Bunny step this year.
Economic factors may take some spring out of the Easter Bunny step this year.
Economic factors may take some spring out of the Easter Bunny step this year.
Economic factors may take some spring out of the Easter Bunny step this year.
Economic factors may take some spring out of the Easter Bunny's step this year.
Economic factors may take some spring out of the Easter Bunny's step this year.
Economic factors may take some of the spring out of the Easter Bunny's step this year.
Economic factors may take the spring out of the step of the Easter Bunny.
The United States was in many senses founded by a journalist, Tom Paine, who called Americans to revolution against a British Empire that was thought to be completely unbeatable. This country was really founded on the concept that if you gave citizens the information they needed, they could govern themselves.
The founders of the United States gave citizens the fundamental right to a free press.
A revolution for freedom of information.
One of the primary reasons for freedom of the press was that it was the only way people outside of power could keep the government from becoming an empire. Stop militarism, stop the corruption, the secrecy, and the cronyism. That was the function of freedom of the press.
There's a reason why our profession, journalism, is the only one explicitly protected by the U.S. Constitution. Because we're supposed to be holding those in power accountable, asking the critical questions, asking the critical questions.
One of the first steps of the new government was to encourage the distribution of independent news through subsidies.
This was actually America's revolutionary contribution. The genius of the subsidies is that it did not discriminate against the content of the newspapers.
The abolitionist movement didn't start in Congress. It started in those freely distributed weekly newspapers. And that was really where we began to address the most fundamental sins of the American experiment.
It's simply information that is power. It's information that frees us, because when people get information, they then can decide what to do.
Media is the conversation we have as a society. It's the way we learn about the world. It's the way we learn about one another. We see the range of public debate constrained because there may be many things that citizens of a democratic society need to know about that private corporations may not be interested in telling them.
Take care, man. Gotta get back.
Sure. Take it easy, dude.
Oh, yeah.
I know that you will.
Yeah, well, the dude abides.
The dude abides.
What would you like to see as your legacy in 10, 15 years?
I set very ambitious goals because I'm quite optimistic. If you look at, say, the 20 diseases that our global health program goes after, I'd hope that within 15 years, over half of those, we could have had a very dramatic impact. Some of them will prove to be harder than others. For example, AIDS, we will have made an improvement, but not the dramatic improvement probably in that time frame. Malaria, perhaps, and a number of the other ones, we have things in the pipeline. So, you know, huge change in the mortality rates in developing countries, which then has this effect of reducing population growth. That's this big benefit that then makes everything like education and nutrition a lot easier.
You've got to realize, folks, and this is absolutely 100% positive, there are people that work for the government that are involved in what's called disinformation. And one of the things that they will do, and this is a very smart tactic and very clever, they will mix truth with ridiculous bullshit that automatically makes you look like a kook. They'll mix some real truth about the CIA, some real truth about the way things are run, and that way it diffuses all those real truths in people's minds. You associate that shit with Bigfoot and psychics. It's a really clever thing. So when you hear a nutty story, we hear someone who's saying something completely ridiculous but also makes sense at the same time, they're probably government agents.
Who knows, right?
I've been accused of being a government agent. I think that's amazing.
The Illuminati and FEMA, they come to take your woman's uterus and plant alien babies.
He's right. I mean, right. It's all true.
It's a fucking bullshit!
No, this is bullshit.
My brain isn't fucking working. I've been drinking beer. This out-of-control, psychotic ninja warfare demon is over here making me look foolish.
And the devil made me do it. Yeah, ladies and gentlemen, I apologize for my evil.
Did you twist you with lies and disinformation? No. Make you think that it's all funny. It's all funny games.
It's Joe Rogan, baby.
Central Texas, Capitol Wars, spires of the Dark Lord, their vision to make us fall. It's the belly of the beast, heart of the empire.
Belly of the beast, belly of the beast, belly of the beast.
Who dares to travel into darkest Mordor? Joe Rogan enters the Central Texas heart of the Dark Empire. This is the Belly of the Beast!
Belly of the Beast!
Belly of the Beast!
Belly of the Beast! Yeah! Yeah!
Satan?
Yeah.
There's something I want to tell you.
What is it, Bob?
Well, Satan, you're my Satan.
And I love you, man. You're not getting your soul back, Bob.
You can't always get what you want, but you can always get a Bud Light.
Jesus?
Forget it, Bob.
Jesus?
Forget it, Bob.
The central banks were created in Europe in the 16th century. There's a very good reason for that. The kings and the princes of Europe discovered from hard experience that they could raise the taxes of their subjects only so far, and then there was a ceiling. They had a tax revolt on their hands. There was resistance, and they had real revolution or revolt on their hands, and they tended to lose their jobs. Or their heads. So that was it, folks. 40%, 43% seems to have been the natural limit. However, once they got the central bank mechanism worked out, this was a whole new ball game. Now the lid was off, and they were able to collect 50%, 60, 70, and in some cases, 80% of everything that their subjects produced. And their subjects did not revolt, did not resent it even, because they didn't know that they were paying this tax through a process called inflation. All they knew was that the prices were going out of sight, and they had no inkling that it was their government in combination with the private banks that were taxing them in this fashion. And so, see, this became a method of hidden taxation, which has continued to this day to be extremely popular with big spending governments.
Geithner was on board at the Fed, the New York Fed, dealing with all these institutions. He didn't get it. And then we had this fellow who came up afterwards, Mr. Friedman. He was on the Goldman Sachs board, and he didn't last too long as the Fed chairman. Why? Because he had a conflict of interest. Is it possible that there's so much conflict of interest here that all you folks don't even realize that you're helping people that you're associated with, and you should be recusing yourself for America's ethics?
I behaved with the...
You don't think you should have recused yourself when you asked Lehman to go in bankruptcy, you didn't put Bear Stearns in bankruptcy, and then you folded Merrill Lynch into... I mean, isn't there some point where you got to say, hey, I got a conflict of interest here? You don't feel any kind of scintilla of ethics on this thing at all?
Totally. I operated very consistently within the ethic guidelines I had as Secretary of the Treasury, and when it became clear that we had some very significant issues with Goldman Sachs and with Morgan Stanley, what I did then, it would have been very wrong for me to recuse myself. What I did was I went and got a waiver from the ethics agreement, because when we had concerns...
Who was in charge of the ethics agreement?
What?
Who's in charge of the ethics agreement that you got a waiver?
We have a office of ethics at Treasury, and we have a White House ethics office.
So you got it from the legal counsel from the White House?
We got it from the government ethics office.
And I'm still going through it.
What?
Pain in the hurt.
Yeah.
Soaking up trouble like rain in the dirt.
Yeah.
And I know only I can stop the rain with just a mention of my Savior's name. In the name of Jesus. Devil, I rebuke you for what I go through and trying to make me do what I used to. But all that stops right here.
Yeah.
As long as the Lord's in my life, I will have no fear. I will know no pain from the light to the dark.
Come
I will
on.
Show no shame, spit it right from the heart.
Come
Cause
on.
It's right from the start that you held me down. And they, nothing they can tell me now. Lord, give me a sign.
Sandra, I want to talk to you about your letter that you received from Charles Manson today. What did it say in the letter about Squeaky?
Just a party and the good people who are called bad.
The word canonized sounds like a religious order. Do you consider yourself a member of a religious order?
In a sense. Mm-hmm.
In one sense, yes.
Your outside world programs people.
Programs people.
Into education and knowledge. I believe what I'm told to believe.
I believe what I'm told to believe.
Don't you?
We have passed through a time of the awakening of people to the nature of the true danger in the world. In the world. We are now deep in a period of action.
In the 19th century, a man named Captain William Morgan was murdered by a group of Masons. Three members of the order kidnapped Morgan to make him pay for exposing the secrets of Masonry.
He was captured by a group of Masons and taken and killed.
He was the first American to publish the first three degrees of Freemasonry. And later on, the perpetrators made deathbed confessions.
Given by a man named Henry L. Valance. Valance revealed how a council of eight Masons had condemned William Morgan to death, and how Morgan had pleaded for his life on behalf of his wife and children.
The story was he was actually drowned after being mistreated horribly for a period of time.
The public outrage over Morgan's death was profound, but when those who had murdered him were sought out, the people of the United States discovered that justice was not so easy to obtain. It was found that they could do nothing with the courts, with the sheriffs, with the eyewitnesses, or with the jurors, and all their efforts were for a time entirely impotent. The Morgan incident became an issue of national importance, not simply because a man was murdered, but more importantly, Americans began to realize that their supposedly democratic country was being secretly controlled by the Masonic Brotherhood. The anti-Masonic Party was the first third party in American politics and eventually became the Whig Party, which is more widely recognized. The party itself was led by former President John Quincy Adams. Adams wrote, "I do conscientiously and sincerely believe that the Order of Freemasonry, if not the greatest, is one of the greatest moral and political evils." In 1829, a New York State Senate committee published its findings on Masonry, stating that its members were found in almost every place where power is of any importance. 5 years later, in 1834, a joint committee in Massachusetts reported that Masonry was, quote, "a distinct independent government within our own government and beyond the control of the laws of the land by means of its secrecy." A monument was erected in Batavia, New York, and remains to this day. To the memory of William Morgan, a native of Virginia, a captain in the War of 1812, a respectable citizen of Batavia, and a martyr to the freedom of writing, printing, and speaking the truth. He was abducted from near this spot in the year 1826 by Freemasons and murdered for revealing the secrets of their order.
George Wilhelm Hegel, 1770 to 1831, was a German philosopher who is today considered one of the most influential thinkers in modern times. Hegel's articulation and teaching concerning successive phases in the consciousness and awareness of man is still part of the bedrock of philosophical teaching. Hegel is known for his theorem, thesis, antithesis, and synthesis. A simplified English translation is problem, reaction, and solution. They secretly create a problem, the general population reacts with fear, and the solution is to transfer power to those who originally created the problem. It is effective and diabolical. Hegelian principle.
In which part of the brain should they screw the spark plug?
A counterpart to Macy's, the Ratio Club was formed in 1949 in the UK. McCullough gave the keynote at the first meeting. Alan Turing, W. Ross Ashby, Gray Walter, and Donald McKay were among its most important members.
Dr. Gray Walter of Bristol. His mechanical tortoise has an electronic brain which functions like the human mind, sensitive to both light and touch. Dr. Walter does many more tricks.
But Gray Walter was more deeply involved in the study of brainwave activity itself. And Walter was the first to experimentally produce changes in brainwaves through the use of flickering light.
Now I'm going to flash a bright light at you. Keep your eyes closed. Please try not to move.
Gray Walter had also worked closely with Norbert Wiener, introducing him in the early 30s to the then mysterious field of brainwave interpretations.
Yet threw them into a panic when stimulation caused vocalization resembling
members of the Macy's conferences. Also sat on the governing board of the International Committee on Mental Hygiene.
Oh my God. Oh no, don't let them take me in there.
Headed by John Rawlings Rees, creator of the Rockefeller Foundation-funded Tavistock Institute and the British Army's chief psych warfare expert during World War II. Mental hygiene went global, and a massive conference was convened in London in 1948 to mold the post-war New World man, starting inside his own head.
Because it enables the individual to fit into an orderly system. Being a member of an organized group offers a basis for emotional stability to every man.
It almost seemed like a global Manhattan Project for the mind was kicking off. It culminated in a report authored by the Cybernetics Conference members, Lawrence Frank and Margaret Mead, and was titled Mental Health and World Citizenship, which focused on the modifiability of man and all of his social institutions.
They come from all sorts of homes, these patients, all kinds of backgrounds.
Political, economic, legal, and religious. His family, his school, and his workplace. In order to influence and change the world's behavior, one human being at a time. It's stated, quote, "The sciences of man offer the hope of a new approach to the problem of war and a world community, and it is the ultimate goal of mental health to help men to live with their fellows in one world, so that men can live together in peace with each other."
The effective hospital must always serve as a refuge station in which they learn how to achieve a better adjustment to the world outside.
Out of the conference, a supposedly scientific World Federation of Mental Health was established. John Rawlings Rees left the Tavistock Institute to become its first president, a seat that both Fremont Smith and Meade would later fill as well. The group's motto, borrowed from the UNESCO Constitution, was, quote, "Since wars begin in the minds of men, it is in the minds of men that the defenses of peace must be constructed."
The problem became one of communication between man and machine, between machine and machine, between machine and man.
Snaps. Neurons that fire together, wire together. Hebb proved that.
I would like to follow that remark. When we were talking this morning, von Neumann was saying that the brain could not be an analog calculating machine, but must be a digital one.
A machine with an analogic part and a digital part.
So the analog part is able to create analogies that mirror observed actions in human beings with whom we communicate.
Such a device may also use data from previous experience to predict the future.
A tapestry woven from the memories of past.
Our brains translated and converted analog symbols embedded in our sense receptors into digital data in our brain. It isn't reality that we see, but rods and cones interpreting the shapes and shadows and colors of the real world.
Plato's famous allegory of the cave. Reality is nothing more than shadow puppets projected on a cave wall.
The whole of man can be controlled through his dependence on his environment. Because the mind is contained within the brain-body mechanism, and thus isolated from the outside world, it is entirely dependent upon information derived from the senses. In other words, the mind is already contained within a natural matrix.
Focused on communication, their main purpose of indicating to what extent science suffers from the babble of its many tongues, and hence how necessary it is for us to learn to speak again to one another.
Good evening. The White House disclosed today that the CIA's drug testing program on unsuspecting Americans
has
been more extensive than the agency had
imagined. Names of doctors, their names of officials, their names of former and present CIA officials who were involved. It could be sensational.
In a recent deposition, Gottlieb conceded the CIA was interested in retrograde amnesia, or blanking out a period of time in a person's memory.
Like they had complete control over me.
It is doubtful that any meaningful form of consent is involved in excessive electric shock treatment and endless tape-recorded messages to sleeping patients.
Cameron wrote, "This was the way to make direct, controlled changes in personality."
And he would say over and over again the actual words that the individual had said. Some kind of a breakdown, and a breakdown in a psychotherapeutic sense.
Some heard the same message a quarter of a million times.
The committee was never able to determine the full scope of the program since one-time CIA Director Richard Helms acknowledged that the program's records were destroyed in 1973 to avoid embarrassment.
As this 1952 CIA memo says, the aim is controlling an individual to the point where he will do our bidding against his will, and even against such fundamental laws of nature as self-preservation.
The CIA did have a great interest in...
At no time has the CIA engaged in any political activity or any intelligence activity that was not approved at the highest level.
Raymond.
Yes, ma'am.
Do you see the Red Queen?
Yes, ma'am.
Now, here's what I want you to do.
My life as a brain surgeon, it has been necessary to operate
some good many men and women, good many hundreds, and to expose the brain under local anesthesia with the patient conscious.
That dental-like instrument in his hand is an electrode. Each time he applies it to the patient's brain, a weak electric current stimulates that part of the brain.
He's awake through it all, and he can tell the surgeon things that will be helpful to the surgeon in terms of this brain mapping.
That's why he's kept awake.
That's why he's kept awake.
In that process, we have stumbled quite accidentally on the fact that there is recorded in the nerve cells of the human brain a complete record of the stream of consciousness.
Looks to me like he's been in an accident.
No, this is an experiment that took place at McGill University. Students volunteered to participate in this study of human behavior under extreme and prolonged...
The first assignment was communication. Maintaining the nerve system of the arsenal of democracy.
Symbols reveal and they conceal. And that's why they're used and that's why they're so important. They reveal to those who have eyes to see and ears to hear.
Corn is an important symbol in masonry and is one found repeatedly in Washington, D.C. But what sort of hidden meaning could apply to corn? In Hebrew, the word for corn is Dagon, which became the name of a Babylonian god. Some believe this same god was adopted by the Phoenicians under the name Dagon. While Dagon was often worshipped as the fish god, he was also the god of corn. His son was known as Baal, who was often called the son of Dagon or the son of corn. Could Baal have been the model for the bearded male images that appear throughout Washington, D.C.? Take note of this image with ears of corn carved into the hair. According to legend, Baal was once slain by the god of death and taken into the underworld. But at some point, he was resurrected, or as it is sometimes called, awakened. At Haynes Point in Washington, D.C., is found this mysterious statue of a bearded giant rising up out of the ground. The statue is called the Awakening. At the higher levels, the Masons secretly worship Baal under a hidden and unusual name.
It's Jobulon. It's a combination of Jehovah, Baal, and Osiris. It's a deity that is not the god of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob.
In fact, it's interesting, Baal, or Baal, is depicted in the New Testament by the Jews as well as Jesus. He's called the ruler of demons. It's another name for Satan.
Well, I think it's obvious that anybody who has the eyes to see can see that Washington, D.C., and indeed many other state capitals, are festooned with occult symbols.
Because these symbols come from the esoteric realm, it is important to define them according to the thinking of occult philosophers. In the book, Masonic and Occult Symbols Illustrated, we find this quote from Masonic author Charles G. Berger, who says that symbols came to have two meanings, the esoteric and the exoteric. The esoteric meaning was the true or original meaning, understood only by a few and closely guarded by them. The exoteric meaning was the invented or modified explanation intended for the many.
What if the brain worked like a computer? If so, could it be decoded and reprogrammed? By World War II, Norbert Wiener had automated anti-aircraft artillery fire, along with his partner, electrical engineer Julian Bigelow.
This mechanical quiz kid digests the data and automatically computes the right lead.
The other two parts then are inputs. The sum is 6 inches.
It used automatic tracking systems that would make decisions or adjustments based on the feedback of changes in course, speed, or wind.
So they will fire not at where the target is now, but at where it will be.
The calculus of the space of what hadn't quite happened yet, like a duck hunter. Wiener's goal-seeking machines would lead the target and time the intersection of the bird and the shot. Intricate activity in the nervous system carries out muscle contractions or muscle inhibitions countless times over, keeping the body on track to grab the water that the mind wants to drink.
You could see from this that if you knew when to make changes and what changes to make, you could continuously defeat the predictions.
Formula for what he termed cybernetics, a phrase he had coined out of the Greek word kybernetes, or steersman. His 1948 book, underwritten by the Rockefeller Foundation and written primarily for trained scientists, summed up cybernetics as control and communication and the animal and the machine. By the time the Macy's Conference reformed in March of 1946, they knew, in principle at least, that the brain and the computer had a common link in their operating systems. The first official Macy's Cybernetics Conference was held in March 1946, just a few months before the passage of the National Mental Health Act, which gave the federal government a new mandate, not just to treat, but prevent mental illness, establishing the National Institute of Mental Health. These cybernetic conferences combine the innovators of the physical and biological sciences with those of the psychological and social sciences to tackle the, quote, comprehensive study of man. Thus, the core Macy's group expanded to include Norbert Wiener, an MIT mathematics professor and child prodigy who earned his PhD from Harvard at age 17. John von Neumann, the Hungarian emigre and member of the Manhattan Project, who had become a pioneer of the digital computer.
The electronic computer.
And who used game theory to analyze Cold War strategic thinking. MIT mathematician Walter Pitts.
Mathematics has been called the one universal language of mankind.
Who was self-taught in logic and co-authored several key papers on brain modeling with Warren McCullough. Rafael Lorente Deneau of the Rockefeller Institute of Medical Research, who had obsessively chronicled the action potentials of neurons and noted their compatibility with electronic and digital systems. German emigre and Gestalt psychologist Heinrich Kluver, who studied visual perception, hallucinations, and mescaline as an experimental physiological psychologist and was best known for Kluver-Busey syndrome, a cognitive impairment triggered by surgically created brain lesions. German refugee and Gestalt psychologist Kurt Lewin, an OSS agent and director of MIT's Center for Group Dynamics, who was closely associated with the Frankfurt School and Tavistock Institute. Editor of the Macy's Conferences, second-order cybernetician Heinz von Forrester ran the Pentagon-funded Biological Computer Laboratory at the University of Illinois. Born in Vienna and part of the infamous Vienna Circle, von Forrester studied physics and conducted radar experiments for the Nazis and subsequently the Allied occupation. Macy's guests included OSS and CIA asset psychiatrist Harold Abramson, who worked on top-secret chemical warfare projects at Fort Detrick, some of which were co-sponsored by the Macy's Foundation itself, and who had run multiple MKUltra projects involving LSD experimentation. The attendees gathered together for 2 days at the Beekman Hotel on the Upper East Side of Manhattan, a few blocks away from the Council on Foreign Relations, which Alan Dulles had led for decades, and from the Rockefeller Institute for Medical Research and Cornell Medical College, where Project MKUltra research funds were channeled into the Human Ecology Fund. The wartime OSS operated out of its headquarters in room 3603 of Rockefeller Center, working side by side with Britain's MI6 and in the same building as the Rockefeller Foundation.
This machine has stored program, and that is the thing which makes the computer revolution possible.
John von Neumann took the stage to update everyone on the progress of the digital computer during the war.
The immense strides in computer technology that were spurred by von Neumann's work.
It was now ready for the next stage of exploitation.
The system calls for the key to be either up or down. The code calls for a dot or a dash.
Norbert Wiener's cybernetic concept held the key as to what they should do with the digital computers they had developed.
The method and the signal are such that they must be fed to the transmitter in a series of positive decisions.
It fused together the working principles of the biological organism, looping systems that maintained equilibrium.
Its maintenance is automatic and seeks to balance any disturbances.
Wiener, Rosenbluth, and Bigelow presented the ideas of their paper, Behavior, Teleology, and Purpose. It was written in 43, but couldn't be published until 1947 due to secrecy. They had a universal mechanism to create goal-seeking behavior that made machines and even people basically programmable. On the influence of a feedback system, Wiener stated,
"The existing natural reflexes are essentially part of the same mechanism that can inform all purposeful activity in automata. One need merely supply a circuit with receptors and effectors. Then they become goal-seeking devices."
Conference Chairman Warren McCullough had taken things a step further, showing how the operation of the human brain can be represented by on and off electric switching devices.
It is stop or go, on or off, one or none.
His 1943 paper with Walter Pitts on the logical calculus of neuronal activity introduced the concept of the neural net and showed how the communication of neurons could be modeled by a digital computer.
The mind, in contradistinction to brain and behavior, emerged in the 1950s as a legitimate object of experimental research. The Neural Nets project of McCullough and Pitts spearheaded this cognitivist turn in the 1940s. Science of mind thus became a science of signals based on binary logic. Neural nets bridged the gulf between body and mind, matter and form.
The comparisons between the central nervous system as an electronic machine and the digital computer as an artificial brain boiled down to questions of logic, mathematics, and the very nature of reality itself. Yale's wartime ROTC training instructor in chemical warfare was none other than Professor
Bertram Borden Boltwood, head of the chemistry department and an expert in chemical warfare.
Boltwood, who'd come from a wealthy family of skull and bones initiates, was on the front lines of discovering the inner world of the atom. A chosen initiate, Professor Boltwood invited young McCullough to his home to discuss the hidden history of science from its mysterious beginnings.
It was just before the Great War ended that he invited me to his home for an uninterrupted talk. He complained to me of his increasing forgetfulness and asked me to spend one evening with him to illuminate the larger picture. He grabbed me by the hands and intently revealed to me the hidden history of science from its mysterious beginning. Ancient Egypt, Mesopotamia, the Phoenicians, Babylonia, and beyond
all shared the mysterious keys to governing early civilizations.
Cybernetic at heart, these inherited secrets fueled the minds of the ancient philosophers and mathematicians. After summing up this history of scientific progress, he paused. The room went silent.
What was the common code between the communication of the nervous system and the computer's binary processing language? They wanted to show the effect of the physical world on the mind in statistical terms or data. Input, output. Eventually, all the entities will sync to the dominant, whichever is making the most accurate and reliable long-term decisions, whoever is setting the pace and the trends, which could carry out any number of simultaneous calculations and feed back into the mental loop.
Albert Pike was one of the most prominent 19th century Freemasons. After the Civil War, he was elected Grand Commander of the Southern Jurisdiction, and he served in that position until his death in, I think, 1891.
Albert Pike's great contribution to the Scottish Rite is his book, Morals and Dogma of the Ancient and Accepted Scottish Rite of Freemasonry. Pike declared that the true definition of Freemasonry is an advance toward the light. The question then becomes, what is the light of Masonry? In Morals and Dogma, Pike wrote, "Lucifer, strange and mysterious name to give to the spirit of darkness. Is it he who bears the light? Doubt it not." Pike was not the only Mason to speak of such things. Manly Hall, in his book, The Lost Keys of Freemasonry, wrote that, "When the Mason learns the mystery of his craft, the seething energies of Lucifer are in his hands."
Fifth generation warfare is an all-out war that is being waged against all of us by our governments and the international organizations to which they belong. It's being waged against each and every one of us right now. And it is a battle for full-spectrum dominance over every single aspect of your life. Your movements and interactions, your transactions, even your innermost thoughts and feelings and desires. Governments the world over are working with corporations to leverage technology to control you down to the genomic level, and they will not stop until each and every person who resists them is subdued or eliminated. The most incredible part of all of this is that so few know that the war is even taking place, let alone that they are a combatant in it. I've often observed that this is a war for your mind, and that the most contested battle space in the world is the space between your ears.
And 1994, Neil Armstrong made a rare public appearance and held back tears as he spoke these brief cryptic remarks before the next generation of taxpayers as they toured the White House.
Today we have with us a group of students among America's best. To you we say, we have only completed a beginning. We leave you much that is undone. There are great ideas undiscovered, breakthroughs available to those who can remove one of truth's protective layers.
The day I was fired, that morning meeting, we had a patient in her 90s who was supposed to go to an assisted living, and the assisted living, they said, was only accepting vaccinated residents. And they wanted to send this lady to that assisted living, but she was refusing the vaccine. She had adamantly refused the vaccine several times, and a case manager, RN, actually said in morning meeting, we're listening and we were talking about her, and the case manager, RN, said, don't worry, we will get that shot in her arm by the end of the day. I actually posted that quote onto Facebook in one of the Stop the Mandate groups, and I was fired that day.
In the Library of Congress, high up in the ceiling, in between two faunish-looking figures with serpents for legs, is what appears to be a traditional crucifixion. But behind the Christ-like figure on the cross is a black, double-headed phoenix. The words in Latin that encircle the image come from Psalm 17:8, a psalm that is often employed in Rosicrucian writings. It reads, "Under the shadow of thy wings, protect us." The question is, whose wings are providing the protection?
From the Christian point of view, we were formed as a Christian nation. But from the occultist point of view and those associated with astrology and the ancient mystery religions, America was, of course, and Washington, D.C. was to represent their position. So you've had the two forces, you know, in America ever since its formation.
Supposedly there was this great, awesome teacher of occult lore who was known as Hermes Trismegistus, which means thrice greatest Hermes, hence the term hermetic. And he produced this book that's called The Divine Pymander. And this is kind of like, if you will, a Bible of ancient occult lore.
In The Divine Pymander is revealed the hermetic maxim, as above, so below, as pictured by this tarot card of a magician with one hand up and the other hand down.
As above, so below, but after a different manner. And what that means is that in esoteric thought, in everything that is above is reflected down below. So for example, a human being is a certain shape and form, but the universe itself is a giant version of the human body. And that everything that is down here has a supernal, macrocosmic, if you will, origin. And that's one of the essential concepts in the occult.
As above, so below is repeatedly symbolized in esoteric art and a variety of symbols, the most basic of which is a triangle pointing upward or above. This is accompanied by a second triangle pointing downward, below. When combined, they form a hexagram, commonly recognized as the Star of David, one of the most dominant symbols in the occult. Removing the base of the triangles, one can see the outline for the square and compass of Freemasonry. Esoterics believe this same principle of reflection can be found in nature, with bodies of water providing a mirror as a picture of the Hermetic maxim. With this in mind, consider the placement of the reflecting pools in our nation's capital, before the Washington Monument, the U.S. Capitol, the Lincoln Memorial, and the Supreme Court.
The Conference of the United Nations on International Organization is now convened.
The United States and the Soviet Union are now among the chief artisans of the new international order.
The United States and the Soviet Union are now among the chief artisans of the new international order.
Chamber of the Chosen.
We are the Illuminati!
You have achieved great power, Joseph Biden.
We control currencies, manipulate markets, communicate with the dead.
We must give you a demonstration of our power. Behold!
That if you recruit two members, you get a share of their entrance fees.
And if they recruit two members, you get a quarter of that.
Sex rituals.
We didn't say anything about sex rituals.
Fresh ideas. Let him speak.
Fine. Take a seat, love.
I can't believe how quickly they accepted that new behavior code. I mean, everyone did it immediately. It was eerie. Discipline is one thing. But there's something more. Feeling that you're a part of something that's more important than yourself. A movement, a team, a cause. We need a symbol for our new community. A wave is a pattern of change. It has movement, direction, and impact. And from now on, we will be known as the wave.
But I don't like it, Laurie. It sounds too much like brainwashing and mob psychology to me.
Sweetheart,
we have raised you to be an individual. Just remember that the popular thing is not always the right thing.
Now, you all have membership cards. If you turn them over, you will find that some of them have been marked with a red X. If you got a red X, you are to be monitors and will report directly to me any members who don't obey our rules.
Can you read this article that I wrote? What are you going to do with it? I'm submitting it to the school paper. You can't say these things about the wave.
Lori, stop writing those articles and keep your mouth shut about the wave.
I will write and I will say anything that I want to, and you can't stop me!
We can and we will. The wave is upon us. Across the country, teachers like myself have been recruiting and training a youth brigade to show the rest of the nation how to achieve a better society. Look what we've accomplished in 2 short weeks in this school alone. If we could change things here, we can change things everywhere. During the rally, a prominent political figure will reveal himself to all of you as our national leader. He will appear on television, and he will announce the formation of a nationwide wave youth program.
Strength through discipline! Strength through unity in action! Strength through discipline! Strength.
In a moment, our national leader will address us. Robert?
Mr. Ross, yes.
Turn on the television set. You traded your freedom for the luxury of feeling superior. Oh, you thought you were just going along for the ride, that you could walk away at any moment. But where were you heading? How far would you have gone? You would have put on the uniforms, turned your heads,
and allowed your friends and neighbors to be persecuted and destroyed? Fascism isn't something those other people did. It's right here, in all of us. We're all responsible for our own actions. You must question what you do rather than blindly follow a leader. Never allow a group's will to usurp your individual rights.
This exercise won't work without your cooperation. Blue-eyed people aren't allowed to smoke. Blue-eyed people aren't allowed to sit in these empty chairs. Do not let a blue-eyed person sit next to you. You know you can't trust them. And besides which, they don't smell good. Everybody knows that about blue-eyed people. You don't know what you can catch from a blue-eyed person. It would be to your advantage in the future, people, if you'd get to meetings on time. And it would also be to your advantage if you'd put your gum away. Put your gum away. You want to get paid for today? Well, then stay, but put your gum away.
I don't have a purse, so I don't have a place to put my gum.
I'm sure that you are inventive enough to find a place for the gum. Now, I'd like for you to notice where she put her gum. You have this problem with blue-eyed people. You give them something decent and they just wreck it. I'd like for you to look at the man in the back, in the black jacket. The game we're playing is playing it cool. This is a favorite blue-eyed game, playing it cool. Nobody can bother me, man. I can handle this. I don't have to do this. I'm going to ignore this whole thing. Sir, I realize that you feel that you don't need to write it down. But whether or not you write it down, perhaps you could remember it.
Okay.
Good listeners have quiet hands, feet, and mouths. Do you know what that means?
I'm not sure.
I believe that. Do you want me to explain it to you?
No, that's okay. I'll get a pencil and write this down directly.
From the last 10 minutes, what have you observed about blue-eyed people?
Blue-eyed people are very stubborn, very self-centered, and wish to control as much of their surrounding as possible, people-wise, I mean. Very inconsiderate people. I don't even know why you have them here in the first place.
We have them here because we are required to have them here.
We have to.
I haven't got it on my paper yet.
Oh, why is that?
I haven't borrowed the pencil to write it down as yet.
Do you think it's unnecessary?
At this particular point, yes, I do.
Why?
Well, I have it in my head for the most part.
There's a lot of space up there for it, isn't there, friend?
With keeping your hands and feet still, as I
recall. Has something to do with that. I find that highly interesting. Stupid, but interesting.
Well, I think it's a game with them. Attention.
Has it gained anything for this gentleman?
Disrespect from, I think, the brown-eyed people.
Has it proven anything to brown-eyed people?
Yes, this is a typical trait of a blue-eyed person.
Now read the second one.
I don't have the second one. Can I read it off her?
You don't have the second one either.
No.
You were keeping it in your head. What happened to that plan?
Just the first one I had in my head, not the second one.
Oh, the other three aren't important?
Well, they're probably important.
But not important enough for you to write down, right?
Well, they're important. I should have written them down most probably.
Most probably?
I'm finding I'm going to have to explain things a bit more explicitly to a blue-eyed person than I would to a brown-eyed person.
How many times did I have to repeat the listening skills for Roger?
Well, Brother Roger is having a rough time today, isn't he? It was about 6 or 7 different times.
You think that's amusing, Roger?
Apparently, somewhat amusing.
All right, I need these names and the scores.
I have KR 11.
I'm sorry, I can't hear you.
KR, just initials, 11.
Just KR, just an initial, no
yeah.
Last name?
No names.
How many?
11. And Churden or Charles, I'm not sure.
Thank you, sir.
You know, it's what you do to the image of blues with your behavior is unfortunate. What you three people do to the image of women with your behavior really makes me angry. The fact that you do this kind of thing and this kind of sloppy work reflects badly on women. I resent that doubly. Yes.
Ma'am, I'd really appreciate it if you'd call us by name. When you say you three people, we don't know who you're speaking to. It could be anyone here.
My dear, if you wanted me to call you by name, you'd have put your name on your paper.
It's on my...
It was to be on your paper.
You didn't see my papers, ma'am.
I didn't get your name either because it wasn't on your paper.
That's right.
All right, now how can one call you by your name if you don't care enough about your name to put it on your paper? Don't expect me to worry about it. Don't expect me to worry about it if you don't put it on your paper. Don't sit here and say my name is important to me after you have just deliberately not put it on your paper. You're being totally unrealistic.
My name was important to me. I remember saying I like to know who you're speaking to you when you say you three.
Then what should you do?
Ask you to use my name, which I did.
And where should your name have been?
Right where it is.
On your paper?
And on my birth certificate.
Is it on your paper?
No, ma'am.
Where'd you get a birth certificate?
Same place you got.
Out of a slot machine, same as you did, lady.
I think you're probably right about your own.
At least I know who my parents are, ma'am.
Is she being rude?
Yes.
She being inconsiderate?
Very.
She being uncooperative?
Very.
She being insulted?
Yes.
Are all those the things that we've accused blue-eyed people of being?
Yes.
Is she proving that we're right?
Yes.
There are exceptions to every rule.
And what are those exceptions?
There are a few important blue-eyed people.
Very few.
You
said that. You think that you're one of them?
No.
That's
good. Then why are you up there, then?
I'm blue-eyed. The difference between you and me is I have a brown-eyed husband and brown-eyed offspring, and I've learned how to behave in a brown-eyed society. And when you can act brown enough, then you too can be where I am.
I wouldn't want to be where you are.
Are you certain?
Absolutely positive.
You like where you are?
I love where I am.
You like it so much that you don't even identify yourself on your papers.
I don't need to, lady.
Her using the term lady, where I'm concerned, what do you think she's trying to do? Is it ignorance or is it deliberately insulting?
I would say it was deliberately insulting.
If it's ignorance, she needs to be taught that to many of us, the word lady is a pejorative. I don't appreciate it. It is, it's a put down, and it's used to keep women in their place.
Correct name.
I'm sorry.
I will call you by a correct name after this. I won't be kind.
That was kindness on your part?
Yes.
Then
I
you are...
calling someone a lady is a kindness.
Then your problem is ignorance.
You can call me lady anytime you like.
I wouldn't do that to you.
No, I know you wouldn't.
I really wouldn't. I think that... And that's part of the problem, is a total lack of awareness and how much you contribute to the sexism that keeps you where you are. Not
I
enough.
Like where I am, lady. I did it again, didn't I?
Yes.
I'm getting kind of fed up with this whole bunch of garbage.
Why?
The brown-eyed peoples are no different than we are. I hate to tell them that. They have these false delusions and such.
Are they being disruptive?
No, you trained them very well.
After a break for lunch, Jane Elliott helped the corrections department employees analyze what had happened.
Did you learn anything this morning?
I think I learned from the experience of feeling like I was in a glass cage and I was powerless. There was a sense of hopelessness. I was angry. I wanted to speak up, and yet at times I knew if I spoke up, I'd be back in a powerless situation. I'd be attacked. A sense of hopelessness. I realized this morning that there were very few times in my life that I've ever been discriminated against. Very few.
And you were this uncomfortable in an hour and a half.
I was amazed at how uncomfortable I was in the first 15 minutes.
I really understood, at least I felt that I understood, what it was like to be in the minority. You know, the statements you were making were groundless and such, and yet we couldn't argue with them because if we argued, then we were argumentative and not listening and getting out of our place and all that stuff. And that was frustrating to me. And then frustrating to me was the other little green tags who were sitting on their hands. My group here was, I didn't think, boisterous enough in our opposition to the whole thing.
Why didn't you people support one another? Why didn't the blue-eyed people on this side just sat there? And let's face it, you covered your asses, right? Why did you just sit there?
Well, I think that's symptomatic of the problem as a whole. We see that
you know, in society in general. You see a few people who are making a lot of noise, and the rest of the people sitting back waiting to see what they're going to do.
Okay, as long as I was picking on you, him, I was leaving you alone, right?
Right.
I'd say a lot of people accept that. They let half a few people do their fighting for them, and they stand back, and if this person's going to win, then they'll get on this side. But if that person's not going to win, they'll stay back over here, you know. That's just how it works.
What can I do for you today?
I would like to raise my debt limit.
Excuse me?
My debt limit, I'd like to raise it.
Because the last time I checked, Mr. Smith, you were in serious debt.
Yeah, it's pretty bad. Figure we should raise that limit.
Yeah, it says here you're $140,270 in debt.
Right, so I figured we should raise that limit to about $170,000.
Do you have some new income that I don't know about?
No, still making about $21,000 a year.
Okay, and are you still spending $38,000 a year?
That's what it says.
So you're adding $17,000 a year in debt.
Wow, is that what it comes out to? Debt limit going up. Ding! I've always been able to raise my debt limit.
Yeah, well, this is a little different. Sorry, Mr. Smith. We can't help you.
You missed a little.
I'm very sorry.
My wife is going to lose it.
Been there.
Wait, this is going to end our marriage. We stopped talking to each other for a month. The baby was totally freaked out.
Wait. You have kids?
Yeah.
Sign there.
All right. Aren't kids a blessing? I mean, she's got plenty of time to deal with all this, right?
Absolutely.
Are we all set?
You're all set.
All right. Let's go, kiddo. We got to meet Mommy at the car store.
Thousands of years ago, the first man discovered how to make fire. He was probably burned at the stake he had taught his brothers to light, but he left them a gift they had not conceived, and he lifted darkness off the earth. Such is the nature of achievement. Man cannot survive except through his mind. He comes on earth unarmed. His brain is his only weapon. The man who thinks must think and act on his own. The reasoning mind cannot work under any form of compulsion. It cannot be subordinated to the needs, opinions, or wishes of others. It is not an object of sacrifice. The Creator stands on his own judgment. The parasite follows the opinions of others. The Creator thinks. The parasite copies. The Creator produces. The parasite loots. The Creator's concern is the conquest of nature. The parasite's concern is the conquest of man. The Creator requires independence. He neither serves nor rules. He deals with men by free exchange and voluntary choice. The parasite seeks power. He wants to bind all men together in common action and common slavery. He claims that man is only a tool for the use of others, that he must think as they think, act as they act, and live in selfless, joyless servitude to any need but his own. It is an ancient conflict. It has another name: the individual against the collective. Look at history. Every horror and destruction came from attempts to force men into a herd of brainless, soulless robots, without personal rights, without personal ambition, without will, hope, or dignity. Everything we have, every great achievement, has come from the independent work of some independent mind. I do not recognize anyone's right to 1 minute of my life, nor to any part of my energy, nor to any achievement of mine, no matter who makes the claim. The mind is an attribute of the individual. That is what the collectivists are now asking you to destroy.
You know, 200 years ago, we were paying taxes to an unresponsive government. Today, if my reading of the country is correct, we're paying outrageous taxes to an even more unresponsive government. Yet I wonder how many of us would attend a Boston Tea Party today.
There are people who make their livelihood by seeing that people with lots of income and lots of capital can get into situations that will lighten their tax burden or eliminate it completely for many years.
Man, that's ridiculous, taxes that my husband and I have been paying. It's about $8,000 a year, and my husband is a musician. And when you think of all the different people that, you know, is really making really hard money and paying absolutely nothing. It's really absurd. And they've been like hounding us. I mean, truly hounding us.
What are you going to do?
Pay it. What else?
Of course, there are people who tell us that this system must be. They say that if there aren't extra profits to be made by capital gains, by tax shelters in real estate and oil, the whole free enterprise system will go down the drain. Nobody will put up the capital to make our economy expand and prosper. They say if taxes go any higher for them, we'd be into socialism, and it would be the end of free enterprise.
This is the inevitable and terrible result of believing that paper can produce as solid wealth as hard labor on the earth. People forsaking the land that made them self-reliant, of rampant speculation abetted by the government. The interests of millions have been sacrificed to the avarice of a few, and meaningless scraps of paper called money or stocks or bank credits have been used by cheats to fleece the public, while government looks the other way. Hasn't the government loaded Americans with enough debt? It can best serve now by keeping its hands out of our pockets. When will we learn that nothing can produce but nothing?
Your occupation, Mr. Wordsworth?
A librarian, sir.
A librarian? Having to do with books.
Yes, sir? Books.
Since there are no more books, Mr. Wordsworth, there are no more libraries. And of course it follows that there is very little call for the services of a librarian. Case in point, a minister. A minister would tell us that his function is that of preaching the word of God. And of course it follows that since the state has proven that there is no God, that would make the function of a minister somewhat academic as well.
There is a God.
Are in error, Mr. Wordsworth. There is no God. The state has proven that there is no God.
Obsolete.
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 You are to be liquidated within a period of 48 hours.
I should like to die with an audience.
It's not unusual that we televise executions. It has an educative effect on the population.
I have no doubt.
We'll show the people how this obsolete man, this librarian, dies.
Your state has everything categorized, indexed, tagged. You are the strength. People like me are the weakness. You control and order and dictate. And my kind merely follow and obey. But something's gone wrong, hasn't it? I don't fit, do
I? Yes, you fit, Mr. Wordsworth. In a few moments, you'll be cringing and pleading just like they all do. We'll see then which is the stronger, Mr. Wordsworth, the state or the librarian.
Would you like to know the method that I've chosen for my liquidation? Well, in a very few moments, here in this room, a bomb is going off.
Misjudged you, Wordsworth.
You underestimated me. I'm going to sit down and read my Bible. The Lord is my shepherd.
Please, please. If thou let me out in the name of God. Let me
out. Chancellor, in the name of God, I will let you out.
Stand where you are. No further. You have been removed from office. The field investigators have declared you obsolete. Obsolete? You have disgraced the state. You have proven yourself a coward. You have therefore no function.
Obsolete!
You are obsolete!
Obsolete!
Obsolete! How can you?
I have brought peace, freedom, justice, and security to my new empire.
Your new empire? Don't make me kill you.
It's your first time, isn't it?
Yeah. What?
You gotta drink if it's your first. We did.
What's it taste like?
It's not too bad. I mean, it's kind of salty, like a steak when you got a nosebleed, you know?
You gotta do it, Robert. It's the spirit of the deer.
When you drink it, you'll be a real hunter. Bottoms up.
Go. Go ahead. Go for it, buddy. All right.
Hey. You did it.
His blood is yours. You know, my dad said that once you do that, there's gonna be something different about you. Always.
I came to the astonishing, in fact, bewildering fact that I'd not come across any evidence that Hitler even knew it was going on, whatever was going on. All the other crimes are there, the killing of the Russian commissars, the killing of British commandos, the lynching of Allied airmen, the orders to wipe out to kill off the mentally insane, the euthanasia order, which has Hitler's own signature on the document. Those are in the files, all the way through from the top right down to the bottom, from Hitler's headquarters right down the street level, you've got the documents. But not this one. Now, the historians, of course, have solved this problem quite simply by not mentioning the gap. I remember when I told my literary agent, Max Becker, in New York, that I'd come across an awful gap in the evidence, which I was going to have to explain openly and honestly by saying that you have to explain the gap by saying that by postulating that perhaps Hitler didn't even know anything was going on because no documents crossed his desk showing that he did know what was going on. My agent, Max Becker, said, for God's sake, David, if you do that, you're bankrupted, and of course I am too, because he's Mr. 10%. He gets 10% of what I do get or what I don't get. And he said, invent evidence. If you can't find the evidence, just invent evidence. Plug that gap somehow, rather like the Dutch boy plugging the gap in the dike. God knows what would happen if that gap was left there. Invent evidence. Just stuff any old kind of newspaper articles in. Anything to plug the gap and make it look as though Hitler knew. And I must admit I was nervous because I thought that perhaps somewhere in the files there might be evidence that I was wrong. I couldn't find it. I spent a lot of effort trying to find it. But I've been heartened in my approach by the knowledge that the documents that I had found about Hitler and the Jewish question, remarkably enough, all the genuine documents about that showed him extending his hand to protect them. So anything that had been done to them had been done by people far lower down the scale, ordinary common criminals, like you have in any national army or in any great police forces, or is the psychopath who will do things, for whom really the head of state can't be personally held responsible, even if he is constitutionally responsible. But of course that's a different shooting match altogether, and very different from this romantic notion which I mentioned earlier about the madman Adolf Hitler personally ordering and giving and having knowledge of the killing of 6 million Jews. That's very different if you accept my notion that the whole tragedy on whatever scale occurred just as a result of these wretched people falling into the hands of a large number of psychopaths wherever they were. And this is one reason why I'm coming under increasingly vehement attack on this world tour. I've had to see one university after another closing its doors to me. See that the documents which do exist in the file, the genuine documents, show Hitler trying to protect the Jews. The Night of Broken Glass, that famous event in November 1938 when thousands of Jewish shops were smashed and burned down and looted and plundered. 60 or 70 Jews were murdered by individual gangsters that night. 100 or 200 synagogues were burnt down. We have to explain how it is that when Hitler gets the word of that at 2 o'clock in the morning, I know because I've spoken to all the people who were with him at that precise moment, I know how he got the news, he pulls out every organ stop to try and stop this madness. He calls in his government, his ministers, Himmler, chief of the SS, Goebbels, the chief of the propaganda. He calls them in and all their officials. He has messages sent out all night by telex and teleprinter to stop the madness. In particular, one document in the files of the German, in the files of the second man under Hitler, Rudolf Hess, issued that very night, 10th of November 1938, it's only 3 lines long. In fact, those of you who bought a copy of my book today, The War Path, you'll find that I print that as a facsimile. 3 lines on Hess's headed notepaper saying, on explicit orders from the very highest level, which must be Hitler, there are to be absolutely no acts of arson or outrages whatsoever against Jewish property or the Jewish community. This means Hitler's intervening. That's repeating, explicitly the document says, repeating the teleprints that we sent out this evening, frantically trying to stop what's already started. The next document, November 1941, Himmler's come to him with a proposal to liquidate Jews being sent out from Berlin. Train, I've got Himmler's own telephone notes, what he wrote down day after day, all his telephone conversations. I'm the only person who bothered to read them because they're in handwriting. And I've mentioned before how lazy the historians are. They only read the printed volumes. And here are Himmler's handwritten notes on every telephone conversation he made during the war. Trainload of Jews, he writes, November the 30th, 1941. Trainload of Jews from Berlin, not to be liquidated. He's making the telephone call from Hitler's bunker to the chief of the Gestapo, Heydrich. Obviously, Hitler has intervened once again to say, are you out of your mind? What are you planning? What are you plotting? Don't do it. A few weeks later, April the 20th, 1942, exactly the same. Himmler in Hitler's bunker, telephoning Heydrich in Prague, the chief of the Gestapo, saying, gypsies, not to be liquidated. Keine Vernichtung der Zigeuner. Again, in Himmler's own handwriting, a document of the highest authenticity. You won't find these documents quoted anywhere in the entire body of historians who are against me. There's another one. It's in, I've got a facsimile I can show you later on if you're interested in my brochure, which I've been using on this worldwide tour. It's from the files of the Ministry of Justice. The spring of 1942, about April 1942, the chief civil servant has written to Himmler, to Hitler. I'm sorry to say that again. The chief civil servant, Dr. Hans Lammers, rather like a prime minister, directly between Hitler and the civil service, has written to the chief of the foreign minister, the Minister of Justice, the deputy minister of justice, a man called Schlegelberger. And in this document, he says, according to Schlegelberger's own typescript note, that Lammers has telephoned to say that the Führer has repeatedly ordained that the solution of the Jewish problem is to be postponed until after the war is over. You see, you're all silent because the very notion that there are documents saying this kind of thing, but there's no document saying the other thing, of course, that Hitler wants it done or that he knows it's going on. That there are documents where Hitler is actually intervening to say he wants the solution to the Jewish problem postponed until after the war is over. It's actually in the files of the Ministry of Justice. Now, this document vanished after the war. It wasn't available at Nuremberg. It vanished from the Nuremberg dock files, and it mysteriously reappeared around about 1950, when it was no longer of any use in the Great War Crimes trials after the war. It's in the archives again now in the files of the German Ministry of Justice. You won't find that document referred to anywhere by the historians either, the historians of the Holocaust. They act as though these documents don't even exist.
Hi, I'm Tom.
Yeah, you told me. Next.
There's a donkey in the bed, a dead hooker in my shed. There's a jet ski in the pool, so much blood inside my stool. There's a dead moose in my car, a dead fetus in a jar. Why's my date look like a dude? Why's my mugshot on the news? Black guy in my bed, and I'm pretty sure he's new. Oh yeah. Got a sore backside, so I'm pretty sure we screwed. Jesus Christ. Wild turkey night. Yeah, I smoked a couple rocks. I jacked off with Icy Hot. Think I fingered Carrot Top. Wild turkey nights. Threw up in a river car. Chugged a beer with my brown star. Then my grandma got me hard. Wild turkey nights. Beat a clown with a crowbar. Put angel dust in my cigar. Shit my pants at the Kmart. Wild turkey nights.